Out. I'm your host, Kim Carey, and today my guests are Jim Cerlesky, who is the president of Leadership Troy, and Mary Kerwin, who is the secretary of Leadership Troy. Welcome you both.
Thanks for having us on the show.
Yes. It's a pleasure to be here.
It is a pleasure to have you. Wonderful. So let's start with you, Jim. Tell us what Leadership Troy is and what your mission is in the community.
Leadership Troy is an umbrella organization for all the community organizations in Troy. It grew out of the 1994 futures work that was done by the city. We were looking for an organization to be able to take a look in that futures report and what was implementable in terms of the good ideas that had come from the citizens. So Leadership Troy was formed to try and implement some of those ideas. What Leadership Troy is all about is looking for people to get involved in various opportunities in the city, and then rewarding those volunteers at our community awards dinner that we hold every October. Mm-hmm. We choose a distinguished citizen for Troy each year. That person is recognized for all their contributions over many years, a full breadth of work. And then what we also have part of that program is to honor a business who has contributed by providing services free to community organizations. And then the community organizations themselves honor a volunteer of the year, and a volunteer of that year appears at our dinner, and we had 15 organizations last year do that. Okay. So again, that banquet is a reach out to highlight all the good volunteering that's done in these cities and honoring those people for their work.
Okay, and you've been a long-standing citizen of Troy.
Yep.
So you've seen some changes. Tell us about how when you first became a resident and how it's changed over a period of time.
What has really grown over the many years I've been here is obviously the development of the city. When I first moved in 1979, my daughter was a month old.
Okay.
And we're just getting used to this city in the northern portion of Oakland County. Mm-hmm. And we had heard was very progressive, had excellent schools. Mm-hmm. At that time, Rochester Road was a two-lane highway.
Can you believe it?
No.
Not anymore.
Not anymore. This was two lanes all the way from the freeway I-75 interchange all the way out to Rochester. Mm-hmm. And that's how it was on much of the other byways and highways here in the city. There wasn't full development of many of those. So what is interesting to see is the development of the city, the various businesses that have come to the city to create corporate headquarters here, mm-hmm. the growth of the school systems, and how those schools have improved in terms of both technology, but also the design of the schools to be efficient, and also the opportunities provided for students now. When I take a look at what my daughter and my son went through in those schools and what they learned versus what I did, it made you want to go back to school and start over with them and walk through all the grades with everything right. that's going on. So you take a look at that, and you also take a look at the growth and the decline of community organizations. Mm-hmm. You see a cycle there, and that kind of gets where we're trying to do as Leadership Troy is to get people back to being more involved in volunteering, and what type of connection can we make with those people to be able to get them more involved in Troy.
Okay, which takes me to you, Mary. Leadership Troy, from a community and youth standpoint, could you just tell us about the connection and the need?
We do call ourselves the community connector, mm-hmm. because as Jim described, and you may remember, years and years ago there would be weekly meetings mm-hmm. of many service organizations, often at lunch, and as a matter of fact would sometimes exclude then some of our youth who are, of course, are in schools at the same time. Mm-hmm. The banquet gave us an opportunity for all of the organizations to come together and learn about each other's and how they're giving back. What we know about the millennials, today's young folk, is they want to become involved. They're very interested in building community, but they're interested in doing something rather than attending meetings.
And what are they doing?
They give back in a number of ways. We know our high schools have Project LEAD, National Honor Society, ways for those kids to give back. Mm-hmm. But as far as the community as a whole, we've not found a link to both those.
Okay.
And that's why we thought we would come today, Kim, and talk about a program that has been recognized by the Michigan Municipal League statewide, mm-hmm. and that's Time Bank.
Time Bank. Wonderful. So, Jim, tell us about Time Bank.
Time Bank is a program that was developed by Dr. Edgar Kahn, a legal professor who was a graduate of Yale Law School. Dr. Kahn worked for many organizations. One of his major organizations that he worked for was the United States government. He was on Robert Kennedy's staff when Robert was Attorney General for the United States.
Mm-hmm.
What happened to Dr. Kahn in 1980, he had a serious heart attack. So while he was convalescing, he started to think, what's going on in this world of ours? What do we need to make it a better place to live?
Mm-hmm.
And what he was seeing is, one, as Mary pointed out, there was less opportunities for youth to get involved, people of other ages, or to interfacing with communities. He was starting to see some of the things we were starting to see, and that is families no longer living close to each other to get things done. No longer neighborhoods like you used to have, where you knew the neighbor behind you, in front of you, on each side and across the street.
That's
and in
true.
Fact, you were playing with most of those kids, or neighbor was helping neighbors. And so without that reach-out type of capability, Dr. Kahn was thinking, now what could we do to try and build something where we do create a community of caring again, like it used to be in the 1800s
mm-hmm.
when the country was being built, or the early 1900s, when that type of dependability was needed to get things done.
Well, it was a different society, more industrial. So, but we still want to keep that connection.
We still want to keep that connection and provide the opportunities. And as Mary pointed out, we were seeing that similarly in organizations,
mm-hmm.
is that with this fast-paced world, people didn't want to get tied down with meetings
mm-hmm.
or constantly fundraising.
Mm-hmm.
What can they do what they feel comfortable doing at the time they feel comfortable doing it, and then move on to something else and or just relax from what they were doing, but not feel like they're obligated to meet this particular meeting time or this particular fundraising activity? What can we do along those lines to create that atmosphere that we used to have?
Is that where Time Bank, the concept, came from?
Time Bank came from that concept. Dr. Kahn took a look at that and says, there's five core values that he built Time Bank on. One of it is asset. That means everybody has a skill set
mm-hmm.
that they can provide a service that somebody needs, no matter what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Then when you take a look at it, redefining work. People define work as putting that particular product out, that particular car or that particular house or that particular clothing or that. We need to redefine work that the work that's also very important is building families and making democracy work in this in the United States and elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So it's building that just as important as making any material good is making those families stronger.
Mm-hmm.
Also, what's important is reciprocity. That people who give of themselves are also should recognize they are receivers. They can use some type of skill. And the people who are receivers to think, yes, they have a skill set that will provide a service to give.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What we also have is social networking, and not the social networking of
today.
Of today with your PDAs or your telephones, and there's somebody, you know,
right.
Down several miles away. The social networking of really being able to help each other out face to face.
Right, and as building. Mary and I were talking, you gave a really good example. Yeah. Share it with us again in terms of exchanging what you can do, a skill that you have that you could share with me. You gave a great example.
I'm passionate about gardening.
Yes.
However, I realize that my body at this point doesn't recover the way I used to
mm-hmm.
from lugging soil in or changing soil. And we know in order to grow, that's something that needs to happen.
Mm-hmm.
So how much I would value a young person's help in preparing that soil for me.
Mm-hmm.
It's a skill that I no longer do well, and yet we know they recover quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be wonderful if I would be able to partner with a young person to help lay the soil. And then as my vegetable garden comes in, I would love to reciprocate from that service, from that use, this connection again
mm-hmm.
with someone who helped me
mm-hmm.
by sharing the produce with them. This used to be a natural, Kim.
It did.
When we were in smaller communities, this would simply happen. But as we've become more isolated as families,
yes.
and as some of us have gotten older and children have moved out, we don't see that anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So as much as I have a need, I also would love to reciprocate in kind.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's benefits that can happen. Whether that's a skill or perhaps you can show me a craft I would love to have.
Yes.
Perhaps you needlepoint or something. This is something I would have learned at one time from someone in a different generation.
Mm-hmm.
And we're missing that. There's a longing for those handcrafts. And then in return, might be able to do something else, whether it's as simple as tying packages, making beautiful wrapping, or any other skill, taking care of pets.
Mm-hmm. So well, I can tell you better than that. If I craft for you, you can cook for me.
I would love to do
that. I don't
that.
Cook.
There you go. There you go.
Which brings us, so that is really what Time Bank is, exchanging.
It really is. What Time Bank is set up is the hour. 1 hour is what the exchange medium is.
Oh.
An hour of service is the exchange medium.
Okay.
And that hour of service, no matter what it is valuable. So when the Time Bank is put together this program, the hour that somebody mentors versus the hour that somebody spends doing electrical repair versus the hour somebody spends taking somebody to the theater or to entertainment is the same in this program. An hour is an hour of service.
Okay. Which brings us to SHARP. Tell us what SHARP means. Each letter means something.
Okay, SHARP means Senior Home Assistance Repair Program.
Okay.
It's a program that was developed here in 2006 and was implemented in 2007. What happened was one of the members of a local church was in a Bible study group. And the pastor came in and said, "I'm sorry I'm late." And I was consoling a parishioner, and before I left, they wanted me to do a simple chore of getting up on a small step stool and taking out and replacing a light bulb, because they no longer feel that the homeowner could go up in that step without feeling that there might be unsteady.
Right.
That pastor came back to this Bible study group, and the study group, before you knew it, were spending the next hour and a half brainstorming various repairs that probably are simple enough to do but are very difficult now for that homeowner to do, because either the spouse is deceased now, used to do that, or again, there's no family members around, or there's no neighbors around that they know of, that they can lean on. So out of that developed the concept that if this program could be successful in a church for those parishioners, it's probably going to be successful citywide. And so North Woodard Community Foundation, which is one of the members of Leadership Troy, worked with the city of Troy to establish a partnership to create that program. And that program started in 2007 with a core of volunteers who were willing to do the work. They were both, some were retired plumbers, electricians, some are others that are working but had good skill sets that would make them available to do that sort of work.
Okay.
And so with that, spread the word in the community that there's this type of service available.
Now, who else qualifies for the SHARP program?
The SHARP program is any senior over the age of 60, anyone who's disabled, and we just this past year included servicemen and women who are deployed.
Very good.
And very what good. We took a look at with that is with that criteria to get the word out that we're able to help you, and we've got the volunteers to do that.
Okay.
So what we've learned from that program is we have no income limit on that program, just like you would not have any income limit on Time Bank in terms of who could qualify and participate. They only have to pay for supplies. And what we found is that the people were thrilled being able to get somebody to do the work for free. And even more important, having somebody come in who would spend the time to talk to them, because maybe that's the only time they had somebody come over for a month because that family's not around anymore.
Okay.
And also to tell them, this is the type of repair you need and what we can do, and if we can't do it, this is all a professional should ask to be done. And we've seen people feel greatly relieved at that, because they were putting off repairs. They either had to spend their money on rent and food or get a repair done.
Okay.
Rent and food won.
Right.
So we saw that, and we also saw people living in questionable situations that if those repairs were let go any longer, it would be an unsafe condition. So we have found that this program of reaching out to the community by these volunteers, there is a need. And thus we were taking a look at, well, if there's that need for home repairs, what can we do to get people of all ages involved? Because really, when you take a look at who's doing the repair work, it's mainly people in their 30s and over. Sure. So how do we get the youth involved? How do we get the people who are in their 20s involved?
Which brings me to you, Mary, before we close out. What would you say to the audience to motivate them to want to be a volunteer?
I think that, in fact, there's a need in all of us to build community once again. Mm-hmm. There was a survey done recently in Troy where it was recognized that there wasn't a sense of community. Mm-hmm. And we know what makes a community is meaningful relationships with each other, intergenerational.
Yes.
And when people go visit leadershiptroy.org,
yes,
they will, in fact, learn more about Time Bank program. They can connect to the North Woodward Foundation, where they can learn more about SHARP. And they can find how we can be connected not only in organizations, but one-on-one-on-one, mm-hmm, and help to build community once again.
Well, very good. Well, I really appreciate both of you coming in and informing us and the community on Leadership Troy, Time Bank, and SHARP.
Well, thank you for the opportunity.
Very good programs.
Thank you, Kim.
Well, that'll do it for us today on Reaching Out. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.
Thank you.